did a postdoc at KAUST in 2010, 7 years ago, and I got addicted with the region and the Red Sea. So since then, although I came to Plymouth Marine Lab, I continued to be working in the Red Sea, and we formed a very, very nice team within PML with Bob Marie, Trevor Suba, and Ibrahim Hotate, who is a professor at KAUST in Saudi Arabia. And we have been combining the ocean color data sets, but other remotely sensed data sets with modeling, with in situ genetics, with ship-borne in situ profiles, everything we could find in order to understand the ecosystem. So starting with a very general question, what limits phytoplankton growth? What do they need to grow? I bet you know. Two main things, light and nutrients. These are the two main parameters that affect phytoplankton growth. And what does it limit phytoplankton? We can see a very nice paper by Donne et al., which was published in 2006. He has this schematic diagram, and we can see that in nutrient-limited areas, like the tropics and the mid-latitudes, these places are nutrient-limited. And that means that warming increases thermal stratification at the top layers, reduces mixing, and the nutrients that are usually coming from convective mixing from below are much less, are reduced. And thus, phytoplankton is decreasing. Exactly the opposite is happening in the higher latitudes, as we saw 2 days ago using the continuous plankton recorder, 70 years versus the northern hemispheric temperatures. We could see that due to warming and thermal stratification, this reduced mixing has a positive effect because the phytoplankton remains at the top lit layers, and thus they can utilize lights more efficiently, and they increase. This is the general model. Of course, there are situations everywhere in the globe that this model fails, and we're going to see one example later on. This model is mainly describing the convective mixing and what is happening with a potential warming. But also, as you may know, the nutrients can be advected on the horizontal part of the oceans. So, why the Red Sea? The Red Sea is one of the most unexplored ecosystems in the world, perhaps due to the insufficient money from Africa's side and due to geopolitical conflicts in the Middle East. In general, this ecosystem is highly unexplored. It is surrounded approximately by 6,000-7,000 kilometers of coastline, and it is highly dominated by pristine coral reefs. So that's why the Red Sea is very, very famous for diving, and it's one of the closest coral reefs within Europe and number one diving spots for us. The coral reefs are very important because they provide vital ecosystem and societal support through fisheries, recreation, tourism. They're very important. However, the biology of the region has not been studied at all. We know a fair bit amount of for the physics. The reason is that this is the shortest commercial waterway between the Atlantic and the Indian Ocean. So most of the container ships, instead of going below Africa, they cross the Mediterranean Sea through the Suez Canal and the Strait of Bab el-Nadeb, Yemen and Somalia, and they go out to the Indian Ocean. Due to the geopolitical situation, but the geographical position of the Red Sea, the US Navy starts sampling the physics of the region quite intensively. And that's why we start having, when this data set were released, scientists start learning about the physics of the region. However, in terms of biology, the only data source to investigate biological processes at large spatial and temporal scale were the satellite-derived data sets. Once I first arrived in 2010, I wanted to see, in addition to the fact that the Red Sea is one of the warmest seas in the world, if there is any indication of climate change in the region. And this could be quite important for the biology, because these organisms, they live in conditions that are predicted to occur in several decades from now in other marine ecosystems. So, in a sense, the Red Sea is making an excellent test bed, a laboratory, a live laboratory for climate change studies on biology. So, when I used and processed the AVHRR dataset, this is what I saw. Not only the temperature in the Red Sea increases, but there is an abrupt regime shift approximately in the middle of the 90s. So, based on your practical, you remember this is anomalies, monthly anomalies, as you played with a few days ago. And as you can see, it helps a lot to separate those two periods. And it's very clear, highly clear, that something happened in the mid-90s, and it's not only the annual variability that is increasing and it's driven by one single month, but as we can see here, most of the months have been anomalously warm after 1994. This is a very nice and easy way to plot monthly time series, because you can easily spot which particular month is where. For instance, this is January, this is December, from 1985 until 2007. Instantly you can tell this is 1995, July, August, summer, and here we have like a very cold event. It's February 1992 towards 1993. This is actually the Pinatubo, the volcano eruption that's the whole globe became colder. The sun was behind ashes, so we had a lot of cooling. And there is a very interesting Nature paper for the Red Sea in Gulf of Aqaba during this period. And due to the intense cooling, there was such an explosive blooms because of the nutrients that came from below, and it's covered corals, and it caused a massive death. Please.
That's data from many
satellites. Yeah. Very good question. Excellent question. Actually, we have approximately 8 to 9 different sensors aboard Nimbus. Nimbus 1, 2, 3, up to 7. They use exactly the same methodological approach. And we have been testing these products in several different regions in the world. And of course you don't see these regime shifts, but that was the first one. Even the reviewers picked it up, and we eventually used, you're going to see a little bit later on. And one thing is that we used in situ data sets, air temperature, because we couldn't find marine to validate the products we are going to see. But it is extremely important to make sure that this shift is not caused by the entrance of a sensor or the absence. This is some in situ data that I got, as I told you, due to the lack of data availability. The only in situ data that I could find, it was from the Jeddah airport. So I actually related air temperatures in the Red Sea in comparison to sea surface temperatures in order to see if this warming has an atmospheric impact or it's a local oceanographic phenomenon. But also to validate the signal in order to start seeing something more to substantiate our results. This is the monthly correlations, and this is after the cross correlation of with a lag of 1 month. Basically, what it's saying is that the air temperature is changing first, and approximately a month after, the marine temperatures follow. We were very glad to see that. First of all, it is saying something about the atmosphere, that it has an impact. Then we related with Northern Hemisphere temperatures and we found significant relationships. I don't have time to go further on that, but we saw some significant relationships between the whole, the climate warming of the whole globe and the Red Sea. So what we see here as warming, it is part of the global warming. Very, very briefly, here I have plotted the marine temperature, sea surface temperature from AVHRR, and this is the air temperature from the annual means, and it's the minimum values. Basically, what is happening, the minimum air temperatures have increased massively after 1994. We don't know the reason, but there was consecutive strong El Niños, and sometimes when an environment changes, it never comes back. This situation is until present, and it is continuously increasing, and we had an even warmer effects approximately 2010 and then 2015. So this warming is actually continuing. It is a pretty abrupt warming. This is the difference between the two decades. This is the difference between this decade and this decade. And we can see that this is for every month. In July, for instance, it is 1.1 degrees, and the rest of the month is approximately 0.7 on average. And in air temperature, for instance, August, we see 2 degrees, and here August is 1.1. This is pretty high temperature difference for the marine ecosystem, but also for the air. And we had like a Rodionov regime shift algorithm to identify if this abrupt change that we found, it is indeed statistically significant, which was highly, as you can imagine. So we wanted to know what is the impact of this warming on the biology. So we really wanted to see decadal trends of ocean color in order to see what is happening. So we didn't have enough data, but Bob visited me while I was in Saudi this period, and we collected whatever data were possible with not many matchups, but at least it gave us an indication that we overlaid to the global data sets, and we can see that the Red Sea overlaps very, very well with the general oligotrophic waters around the globe. It was the first instance that we could say, yes, the ocean color from space, it is giving a good value. A few years later, more cruises were collected, and we start seeing some very interesting results. Very positive, significant relationships, but as you can see here, with a constant overestimation. We identified that this is probably due to CDOM, and we applied some CDOM algorithms from Andreas Morel's work in the Mediterranean Sea, and we tried to improve. And indeed, Bob made ocean color index, a regional algorithm, which was this effect was improved massively. This CGOM was not due to the atmospheric difficulties of the region, but it was indeed an oceanographic phenomenon. It was part of the biology and the physics of the region. And there is another colleague at KAUST, Malika, that is working on CDOM, and through her postdoc is collecting CDOM measurements, and she has submitted a very interesting paper on in situ CDOM, and she has found exactly the same thing, that the sensors are overestimating. There is an excess CDOM, and with algorithms we can account for this error and improve it. And this is from Marie Fanny Racault, a very interesting image. You can see the red dots are on the coral reefs. So we wanted to know if the ocean color at these extremely difficult environments of coral reefs are working. We got a positive relationship, of course, with the many difficulties, and we know that this signal, the ocean color, the chlorophyll, on top of near coral reefs, of course, it has acknowledged weaknesses from bottom reflectance, sediment, sedum resuspension. 95% of the marine life lives on coral reefs. However, that positive relationship encourages us to have a look at trends and seasonality over coral reefs. The chlorophyll from satellite is working adequately to give us some very nice information. What does the signal represent? How deep does it actually go? This is what we see from satellites. This is the deep chlorophyll max. And this is what we actually capture. If there is a region with strong cyclonic eddies and convective mixing, then we get a very good idea of However, there are regions of horizontal advection, more or less, this is what we see. And this is another study that I did with my PhD student at Qatar for the Arabian Gulf. And the Arabian Gulf is a very eutrophic region, and you can see with vertical profiles, this is chlorophyll during winter, spring, summer, and autumn. And you can see that again, it is capturing very little, approximately 8 meters, the top 8 meters. The Arabian Gulf is very eutrophic. So what do we see with this data set? We can see that the Red Sea is a winter blooming environment, like most of the tropics. You must have windier conditions, colder conditions, which is happening during the winter time, in order to initiate the bloom. That's why after the seas of the summer, we have an increase in the winds, colder temperatures, and suddenly we have the initiation of the bloom that they peak at the top of the winter, approximately January and February. This is throughout the Red Sea, and this is what is happening spatially. One very interesting thing is that we have some peaks, especially in the southern. We lost a poster. Don't worry. We can see during the summer that we have some peaks almost everywhere except at the north. And we can even see during summer that there is an intense chlorophyll bloom. The Red Sea was like a very difficult ecosystem to understand at the beginning, because it was not like the typical tropical ecosystem that you have a perfect relationship, negative relationship with temperature, and you can start understanding the physical mechanism. The Red Sea is a semi-enclosed sea, so you have a very strong impact from the Indian Ocean, and we're going to see a little bit later on all the different mechanisms. I'm going to show throughout the whole talk several examples, blending modeling and in situ data set together on the top of the remote sensing in order to see how we could understand this ecosystem. So, the Red Sea not only is an extremely warm ecosystem, but it has negligible precipitation. It has approximately 2 centimeters per year. Yesterday in Plymouth it rained approximately 3, I think, during the whole day. So literally near the Red Sea, it's an arid environment. It doesn't rain. It is always sunny and a little bit cloudy occasionally a few days. Also, there is no river input. So where do the phytoplankton get the nutrients from? We have two main systems. One is at the north, and we have the convective mixing. If there is a cyclonic eddy, it is permanent. We even see it here. We can see higher chlorophyll, higher in spring, a little bit higher even in summer, and a little bit higher in autumn. There is always a permanent feature. And then we have the rest, that we have just a few cyclonic eddies, but they're not that powerful. So this one, we start having indications based on the physics that the Arabian, the monsoons and the influx from the Indian Ocean is driving this, and we're going to see it a little bit later on. The monsoons that you're going to keep hearing are actually responsible for the nutrients. So whatever we couldn't get from the precipitation, the rivers, the monsoons, the Indian monsoons, are bringing it in. So we can see here that during winter time, the monsoons have this direction, whereas during the summertime, abruptly, they change to anticyclonic, and then during the winter, the cyclonic movement. During these movements, the winds are orographically constrained and they enter inside the Red Sea, and they're pushing water masses from the northern Indian Ocean into the Red Sea. So all the lack of nutrients that this arid environment has, it is actually taking from the Indian Ocean during the winter, approximately in October until March, all these cold, fresher, nutrient-rich water masses are entering in the Red Sea. All right. Can you still hear me? Oh, okay, now? Very good. Maybe I shouldn't do that. All right, so where was I? These winds are the key drivers for and responsible for the nutrient influx into the Red Sea. The monsoon also is affected by ENSO, and I think Marie-Fanny Racault spoke to you this morning about ENSO and the multivariate ENSO index. So let's have a look briefly. The southern Red Sea, as we can see here, this is the monsoonal reversal that you can see here. This is from June until September, and this is very, very strong from November until March. What is happening in the southern Red Sea? During the winter time, we have a northward current, which means during the winter, the currents are pushing the water masses northward. During the summer, all this water, the wind is blowing southwards, and it's pushing the water masses outside of the Red Sea. We were in an attempt to try to understand what affects the interannual variability of chlorophyll, we wanted to use the multivariate ENSO index. We have seen a very interesting paper by Berenfeld in 2006, where he showed that the tropical primary production and chlorophyll over the globe is significantly negatively related with MEI, which means during positive phases of ENSO or El Niño, the extreme ENSO event, and during negative ENSO phases or La Niña, when it's an extreme, we had exactly the opposite situation in phytoplankton. The reason is vertical mixing during positive phases of ENSO, during warmer periods of time due to thermal stratification, less nutrients are convected from below, thus less phytoplankton. And exactly the opposite during La Niña. During colder periods of time, you have cooler conditions, the convective mixing is much higher. So we wanted to test this multivariate ENSO index for the Red Sea. So we selected the period that we had ocean color data sets, and this is what we found. Exactly the opposite of what it was expected. So I said, right, I'm very happy for the relationship, but why? Why? We have here the annual mean. As you can see, it is matching nearly perfectly with a climate index that is, as we said before, it is affecting half of the whole globe. It is a global phenomenon. However, it is on the Pacific Ocean, and it is based on environmental conditions in the Pacific Ocean. How could it actually be related with the Red Sea? So then we start looking. Here is the anomalies, and here is the cumulative sums of the monthly anomalies, as you did during your practical. This example is quite good, and you can see how well clarifies the story and the positive consecutive anomalies, and positive and negative, they follow very well each other at a monthly base, which if you plot the raw data, it doesn't look like. But when you decompose the signal with anomalies and the cumulative sums, you get a very clear idea, nearly as good as the annual mean. So let's have a look why this is happening. This is again the multivariate ENSO index and chlorophyll overlaid on the top, and you can see this very significant relationship. And during the positive ENSO phase, we can see that the winter bloom, the winter chlorophyll of the region, has been increased by 75%, and it remained due to the consecutive years of positive ENSO. So we were very curious to see why this is happening. As I told you before, and we selected this particular period because we have 3 years of La Niña and 3 years of El Niño to compare, to put the environment in terms of winds, the monsoons, everything over the region to see what is different. And this is what we observed. We created maps, we subtracted this period from that. Basically, as I told you before, the winter monsoons are the ones responsible for bringing the nutrients inside. The nutrient influx is happening strongly during the winter time. So during positive phases of ENSO, we have a very clear increase of wind speed. These northward currents are increasing, and this is increasing chlorophyll everywhere in the Red Sea, except this particular region, which is the cyclonic eddy. I'm going to talk later on about that. This increase in the nutrient influx, if we can say, it is not only affecting chlorophyll in the southern Red Sea, but everywhere, as we can see, and it's not only affecting the abundance of biomass, but also the bloom timing and the duration. Basically, during this positive Enzo El Niño period, we have approximately 4 to 5 weeks longer duration in the bloom timing and in growth. This is an indication of the surface currents during winter and during summer, during positive MEI phases and during negative. It is very clear that during positive MEI phases, the northward currents that are controlling the nutrient influx are much higher than normal, whereas during the summer we don't see any difference. That was another indication. So to get a direct relationship, we did the pixel by pixel correlation between the wind speed and the MEI, and we can see that during when the Enzo is at a positive phase, we have a very high positive relationship over the region that the monsoons are having this cyclonic movement and the influx is entering inside. And this is the relationship between chlorophyll and the monsoons, and this is the relationship between chlorophyll and MEI, a significant positive relationship everywhere. So what we see as the annual mean that I showed you previously, that one which is the whole Red Sea, we applied this relationship for every single pixel every 4 kilometers in the Red Sea, and this is the result. Okay, this is the annual, and we can see everywhere except that part, which is exactly the opposite actually what is happening. To summarize this mechanism, this is the global winds during the winter time, this is the correlation between the Enzo and the meridional winds. So the winds that are moving that way during the winter time, and we can see clearly that during positive Enzo phases, the last 60, 70 years that the model gave us, we have an increase of those zonal winds, sorry, not meridional, of the zonal winds are increasing significantly. What is happening during positive, these winds are increasing significantly. The nutrients, the wind is increasing rapidly, more nutrients inside, more phytoplankton. During negative phases of Enzo, we have less nutrients, less phytoplankton. This is pretty apparent everywhere except the northern Red Sea. Let's have a look. This is the northern Red Sea, and you played with the data set during your practical yesterday. You saw something similar to that. Very good negative relationship. This is February, the peak of the chlorophyll over the region, and you can see a perfect negative relationship. And in 2010, for instance, that we have one of the strongest El Niños, we have the lowest chlorophyll bloom happened. Very, very strong. My PhD student at KAUST is blending modeling, mixed layer depth, and we overlaid with the chlorophyll, and we can see a significant positive relationship, which means the deeper the mixed layer, the stronger the phytoplankton blooms. Because the deeper the mixed layer, the more nutrients you have in the water column. These trends we can see with this does not only impact chlorophyll, but also impacts the bloom timing. And we can see here, this is a paper that John submitted it a couple of months ago. And here we can see the phenology metrics. Marie-Fanny Racault talked to you about the phenology metrics, the initiation, duration, and termination. And we can see this is the mixed layer depth, and these are the heat fluxes. Basically, during warmer periods of time, when we have intense warming, we can see that the initiation is happening much later, approximately 2-3 weeks later. The duration is much shorter, and the termination is also taking place earlier. During colder periods of time, the termination is much later, and the duration longer, and the initiation earlier. So we can see that the warming has an actual effect on the bloom timing and not only on the actual number of concentrations. That was the winter, what is happening during the winter. But as I told you, we saw some very weird signals during the summer, which doesn't make any sense because the monsoons, as I told you, during the winter are driving water masses inside the Red Sea, but during the summer it is exactly the opposite movement, and they drag water masses out of the Red Sea. So from where do phytoplankton find nutrients to grow at the peak of the warmest months of the year, during the highest thermal stratification? We could not find out, and that's why in the first publications I was talking about the winter blooms. The reason why? Because the summer blooms were not really apparent. We have a data gap, massive data gaps, with single sensors. As you already know, based on the Ocean Color CCI, we start having a view of the summer for the first time, actually. If you can see here, this is the climatology of 14 years from MODIS, you can still see gaps, which means literally there are weeks that have never been sampled by MODIS in the southern Red Sea. This is certainly a problematic region, as you can see. This is due to haze and cloud. It is too warm during the summer, a lot of humidity, haze, and light clouds that prevent the signal. So we tried to understand. It was for the first time Marie-Fanny Racault ran the phenology algorithm, and we could understand the spatiotemporal distribution of phytoplankton during the summer. Basically, to give you an example, the northern Red Sea that we observed previously, this is the data coverage from different sensors. Pretty good coverage, we were happy. But look at during the summer what is happening. At the southern Red Sea, this is SeaWIFS, MODIS, and MERIS. And this is the CCI, and you can see how much better coverage, and we were very confident with this coverage we will be able to tell the seasonal cycles. And we worked intensively in a very nice paper that has also won a competition. Marie won a very nice competition, global competition of ESA, the European Space Agency, on her work on the Red Sea. And here we can see the initiation of the bloom, which starts approximately at the end of November, and we can see the peak, the termination during winter and during summer. But what is happening? What is bringing the nutrients during the summer? With Dennis Drino, we worked here. He was a PhD student at KAUST, and he visited a few times, and we worked on the southern Red Sea and the mechanisms. This is the seasonal cycle. The last 14, 15 years, at least 15. We can see that the peak is in July. Where do they find the nutrients at the peak of July? We had some in situ data sets and some data from circulation model. Basically, what is happening, we have, as I told you, the summer monsoon is taking the surface water masses outside of the Red Sea. So there is an outflow. During the same time, there is a very strong upwelling happening in the Gulf of Aden that is pushing water masses into the Red Sea. As the water masses are coming out from the Red Sea, but the Gulf of Aden is pushing waters inside, there is an intermediate water that is coming in the Red Sea. So we have an influx of this tongue of fresher, colder waters that are penetrating the Red Sea, and these are also nutrient rich. So we start getting an idea based on the physics of the past, a model, very clearly what is happening. The southern Red Sea is extremely shallow, so this intermediate water that is entering in the Red Sea is actually distributed very well. I'm going to show you an image I'm going to show you now. This is salinity. We can see that these fresher waters are entering and are actually distributed in the coral reefs of the region. And here, from in situ data sets, this is what Woods Hole found. James Churchill found that these water masses that are entering from the Indian Ocean are nutrient-rich, and they distribute nutrients in the southern Red Sea. Another work that we did to substantiate these results with John Gittings while he was here at a placement year at Plymouth Marine Lab. He used the OCCI data with a good coverage in Gulf of Aden and running phenology algorithms. It was the first time that we could actually identify the seasonality of this particular environment. It is very important to identify the phenology metrics because they're extremely important for the fish larvae and for the rest of the organism. Why is that? One of the Nature papers of Trevor Platt, he explained a very nice mechanism, and we can see here the anomalies in the timing of the spring blooms, and here the survival rates of some pelagic fish. And basically, he's showing that if the bloom is approximately 2 to 3 weeks earlier, we have much higher survival rates. If the bloom is happening 2 months later, we have a much less survival rate. And he simplified by this figure. The overlapping area, the larger the overlapping area is, the more survival rates. As you can see, this is the larvae, this is the algae. If they overlap more, that means there is no starvation. So it was quite interesting to see all these interesting mechanisms in the Gulf of Aden. And we spotted some very interesting blooms at the peak of the summer. And this is due to a regional upwelling, as I told you. And this is where it is happening, and it is very apparent that during summer, we have, due to the summer monsoons, we have a very strong upwelling in the Gulf of Aden, and we can see it here during the summer. The temperature the thermocline is much higher. It is a nutrient at the top, and nitrate and phosphate. And this upwelling, as we said, is pushing water masses, nutrient-rich water masses, into the Red Sea. So it is amazing to see the impact of monsoons and the monsoonal reversal that has on an ecosystem that is lacking nutrients from the land. So now I'm going to take you to one more study, and I'm going to finish quite soon. You have seen several applications of ocean color and different satellite remote sensing data sets to study the different mechanisms of chlorophyll. Here we used the ocean color and the sea surface height to study coral reef connectivity. What is coral reef connectivity? It is the way that coral reefs communicate with each other. It is essentially, it is the exchange of genetic information in between them. And of course, the more genetic variability you have in a reef, this is very good for the immunity. It maintains biodiversity, but also resilience to anthropogenic impacts like climate change, which part of it is certainly anthropogenic, overfishing, and also disease, any kind of pressure, the reefs are becoming more resilient. We wanted to study this reef connectivity and how they are connected within the Red Sea. We used the ocean color and overlaid on the top the geostrophic currents in order to see if it has an impact on the larvae distribution. So here you can see these are the coral reefs within the Red Sea. It's almost everywhere. And here we can see some fantastic cyclonic and anticyclonic eddies that are dragging water masses from one side of the Arabian Peninsula to Africa and vice versa. They're pretty fast. Let's take this example. And we overlay the geostrophic currents from satellites, and as you can see, there is a cyclonic and anticyclonic eddy working at the same time here and here, dragging and creating a corridor of productive water masses that are dragged from the Arabian Peninsula to Africa. It is a very clear example that those cyclonic and anticyclonic eddies and the surface currents are capable of transferring biological material from the reefs outside. The first question, is this biological material or is yellow substances, sedum, sediments? Well, this is 400 kilometers, it couldn't be sediments, but other substances. So we were very lucky to have in situ measurements from a cruise that happened in 2010, and it has sampled the waters during the eddies. In the white circle inside, we can see the chlorophyll from the in situ measurements were overlaid on the top of the ocean color image. Clearly, we can see that the coral reef regions are indeed having higher biomass. So these water masses are indeed more productive than the oligotrophic region. So that gave us hope that this strong circulation flow is capable of transferring biological matter. This is something that we start working on. We finally did not include it in the paper because we wanted pure satellite data set, but this is data from a model that we released particles and then we followed, and we can see their movement vertically and how deep they go, which is important information. We found a very similar value actually based on the model that is running approximately 25 centimeters per second, which it will cover the 200 kilometers in 10 days. This is exactly what we found here, that this distance can be covered within a couple of weeks. This is quite important information because when the fish spawn, it is important that these eggs or larvae or tiny individuals can be transferred on the other side within time. I wanted to, when I was starting the discussion, I wanted to see if there is any relationship between the genetics, the genetic differentiation, and the eddies and the circulation. This is from one PhD student at Kaust, Peng Zhang, that published, this is the Red Sea, and you can see here the central Red Sea has the biggest radius eddies, the biggest and the highest number of eddies. Another PhD student, Gerrit Naniga, at the same time published this genetic data set of the clone fish, Nemo, along 1,500 kilometers from every reef in the Red Sea. What he found is that the central Red Sea has the lowest variability, in a sense that the genetic information here was actually matching throughout the whole Red Sea. And Peng found that this region as well had the strongest eddies and the eddies that they were lasting the longest. So then I stopped writing the paper and I said, I want these data sets and I would like to try to find more to substantiate the results. Of course, it delayed for more than a year the research, but it was an interesting outcome. So what we did, we took the areas that the genetic information has been picked up and we released particles on the top of every coral reef from these reefs. What we saw clearly that the particles that were released in the central Red Sea were distributed everywhere, whereas in the northern Red Sea they were remaining in the north and in the south, mostly in the south. There is a very nice statistical model that is using this information to derive source and sink dynamics. What do we mean by that? We can actually calculate, based on the remote sensing information of geostrophic currents, which reefs are more important than the others. Which reefs are the sources, which is extremely important for conservation. So which are the reefs that dominate and they enable all this movement of larvae? As we can see here, the central Red Sea appear to have the biggest source dynamics, whereas the southern Red Sea has the lowest. Then the reviewer, of course, our best friends are the reviewers, because they're protecting us before we release some results. Of course, we go through difficulties, but certainly these people are our best friends. So my best friend told me, I don't like the fact that you have released particles only from one side. Please release it everywhere, and instead of 19 sides, I would like 30 and 30 to cover every coral reef. And then if you find the same results, I will be happy and say, yes, the central Red Sea has the majority of the source reefs. So this is what we found. Indeed, the mean connectivity time was the lowest in the central Red Sea, which means it can distribute material very fast all over the Red Sea. And indeed, the source strength of the northern Red Sea, north central, is the highest, and the destination's strength as well. Which is very important for conservation. If the government asks which reefs should we protect it first, these are not the reefs according to Callum, Robert Callum, fantastic paper in Science 1997, onwards several, fantastic work on the coral reef conservations. He mentioned that if a region is problematic and the reefs have an issue, you should not try to protect the problematic reef. You should try to protect the source of this reef, the mother reef that is constantly supporting the reef with new larvae, new material, and helping the reef for the resilience. So this was quite important, but as you can imagine, this is purely based on satellite data set. Does it really have any ecological substance? And this is where we use the genetic material to plot the geostrophic currents versus the genetics. And this is our results. These are geostrophic currents, the mean connectivity time, the last 22 years, released from every coral reef that the clone fish genetic material came. So basically, in simple words, this strong dynamic eddy circulation is capable of distributing genes all over the Red Sea. And the reefs, the important reefs that they were identified by the satellites, indeed have an ecological substance and are important reefs for the genetic of the region. So, I'm finishing. Please wake up, take away message. The tropical oceans are predicted to become warmer and less fertile due to thermal stratification. We see exactly the opposite in the Red Sea, and this is because the Red Sea relies mainly on horizontal water fluxes from the Indian Ocean. Responsible for the winter and summer blooms almost everywhere in the sea, Red Sea are the monsoons, except the northern part. The Ocean Color Climate Change Initiative dataset has helped us a lot to identify blooms that we have never seen before. The satellite-derived datasets are efficient tools in tracing surface circulation. These results are quite interesting because the currents from satellites occur for all over the globe the last 23 years. So in areas that we don't have genetic datasets to test, you can still attempt to identify the important reefs, the mother reefs of the region, based on satellite datasets which are freely available globally. So we need to continue monitoring the function of the Red Sea ecosystem from space, and this team at PML will certainly continue. So I'm going to close with a more poetic slide. Sensing ecosystems from space is certainly challenging. We observed dynamic and beautiful patterns that we admire, but we do not necessarily understand them. Thank you very much.